Ông quên chỗ. Ông chúng đẹp cảm to cái tâm ca này tệ vị thi sạm là ca. Hay một nâng một to sẽ đạp được khai cảm sạ xây lại chúm niến ông chúng đẹp xông một chiếc. Tha ông chúng đẹp ảnh nhà tam tâm nào xông đồ bỏ sạm thì vì cả việc đầy nôn chía. Để bàn tâm nào xông phát đo chia cửa nấu ai cửa xá. Tất đo lại chúm niến rụng đi. Hay ông chúng đẹp xông rụng lực. Phong đáy tha ông chúng đẹp ảnh nhà đã đạp tại ai cửa xá ná. Để bàn tự tù dốc chia ai cửa xá phó tàng rồi hỏi thay bật nó. ไอ้องค์จําเริญก็สมบัจจ์ใส่ตํารัจบักขลุนในปัญหา1ได้ Hay ông nhầm đây có xong sân áo xong đó lũ sợi nẹ chùm niến xong mê ta trả lời tốt tên nâng xùm núa ở bàn dứt dứt bọn tích đầm bầy ở nẹ bộ prai phía xa tòa mọt nâng bàn bộ prai nơi rôl chùm lời bằng phư bằng lũ sợi nâng bàn lọ bình lính vì bộ nợ tín ít prai phía xa bay phía xa ông lý phía xa và răng hay nâng phía xa khmai mà xong quân នៅក្នុងការសួនដល់ថាថៃរូបនេះអនុវត្តតាមបទបញ្ញត្តិនៃវិធានប៉ែកកៅសឺមួយស្ទួននៃវិធានទីក្នុងអង្គជំរះតឡាតបងផ្ដាល់វេទិកាជូនទៅថាមេធាវីការពីក្តីខៀវសំផនសួរដេញដល់អ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះមុនភាគីដទៃទៀតនឹងរឿងក្តីហើយមេធាវីខៀវសំផនរួមទាំងមេធាវីការពីក្តីនួនជាមានរយៈពេលសរុប 3 វគ្គនៃថ្ងៃសប្តាហ៍ក្នុងការសួរដេញដល់អ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះសូមជឿន Bonjour, Madame Peggy Levine. Je m'appelle Peggy C. Je suis coordonnatrice internationale de Vous avez fait état avec Monsieur le Président de deux publications. La première, votre thèse, The Contextual Study into the Weddings and Births under the Khmer Rouge, The Ritual Revolution. Document E3-1794 et le livre que vous avez publié sur la base de cette thèse, Love and Dread in Cambodia, Weddings and Births and Ritual Harm under the Khmer Rouge, document E3-10677. Le côté pratique de mon interrogatoire, Tout d'abord, au sujet de vos deux publications, donc votre thèse et votre ouvrage de 2010. Est-ce que vous pouvez indiquer quelles sont les différences essentielles? Est-ce qu'il y en a beaucoup? Est-ce qu'il s'agit dans votre ouvrage publié en 2010 de compléments? Est-ce que vous pouvez indiquer quelles sont les différences entre les deux documents?
Thank you. Yes, my first answer relates to an unfinished question in the first session. My PhD thesis has 178 references in the bibliography, and my book has 184. So several more. There were a couple of other publications that came out between the time that I submitted my thesis is submitted and goes for a period of time. And in Australia, our theses are sent out to international examiners. So it takes a while for them to come back. So from the time I submitted my thesis in 2006, it did not really finish its completion until 2007. So between that time of 2006 and the time my book came out, that was submitted for publication in 2009, that takes a year. In that time frame, I added seven more publications. Most of those were documents that were in the media, where the word forced was used. The difference between the PhD thesis and the book is the audience. So, for example, knowing that I would expose myself a bit and become a bit vulnerable if I published my data for other researchers to have access to, I made the decision to do that in my thesis. And so the end of my thesis has 192 for my formal sample with a synopsis around the data, whereas the book has just my first sample of 11 couples, 22 subjects, and their summarized data. There's less detail around my literature review in the book than there is in the thesis, and perhaps less analysis where the reader can follow the steps by which I came to conclusions in the book than there is in the thesis. Those would be the major differences.
Donc si je dois résumer, c'est un petit peu votre ouvrage est un peu plus grand public et votre thèse, évidemment, comme travail de recherche, est plus scientifique, on va dire ça comme ça, parce que je résume bien les choses.
Yes, I would agree with that. And I would add one more thing, that my book allows, my thesis allows the reader to see the steps by which I moved my methodology forward from a sample that was selective to a sample that was random for more generalization across the population. That would be another major difference.
Je vais précisément revenir un petit peu plus longuement sur votre méthodologie tout à l'heure, d'ici un petit moment. Mais avant d'arriver à ce point-là, j'ai une question par rapport à votre parcours. Nous avons à notre dossier l'intégralité de votre CV ainsi que la liste de vos nombreuses publications et à l'attention de la Chambre et des partis, je fais référence au document E3-433.1. De votre parcours, il ressort, vous avez une formation en philosophie, en anthropologie médicale, en psychologie et en sociologie. Ma question est de savoir si dans la manière dont vous avez abordé vos recherches, vous avez appliqué les méthodes de recherche de toutes ces disciplines ou est-ce que vous avez privilégié un domaine en particulier, et là je parle de votre thèse.
My apologies.
Kim Somtopong.
My research and thinking and analysis on a regular basis is informed by a multidisciplinary foundational background, you might say. When I started my PhD and I was at Victoria University, I had qualified as an anthropologist with regard to my capacity to understand and operationalize ethnography. After doing that and then transferring to Monash University into Monash Asia Institute in Asian Studies, the second half of my thesis I think was much more multidisciplinary, but I did follow the foundational principles of ethnographic research from an anthropological background.
Je suis désolée, c'est que des fois, enfin, si j'ai un air perplexe parfois, c'est que j'essaie de suivre avec la traduction et que parfois il y a des termes qui ne sont pas toujours simples. Une question, alors moi je ne suis pas du tout spécialisée du domaine universitaire, mais le libellé sur votre thèse, c'est un doctorat en philosophie. Je ne sais pas si c'est une philosophie au même sens qu'on l'entend en français, pour moi, beaucoup plus restreint que l'anthropologie, ou est-ce qu'il y a un sens en termes de dans les études anglophones qui est un petit peu différent? Est-ce que vous pouvez préciser ce point?
The Australian PhD, Doctorate of Philosophy, very much follows along the lines of the American PhD, which means that you can do a Doctorate of Philosophy and specialize in a specific discipline.
Je vous remercie de ces précisions. Je voudrais maintenant m'intéresser à votre démarche de recherche plus spécifique pour votre thèse. Vous avez évoqué, vous dites également aussi en avant-propos de votre thèse, sur la manière dont vous êtes intéressé au mariage. C'était un peu un hasard au départ. Vous étiez au Cambodge pour travailler sur un autre domaine et c'est à la suite de discussions avec vos collègues que vous vous êtes intéressé à la question spécifique du mariage. Vous avez indiqué, vous l'avez redit encore ce matin, qu'au départ, vous aviez cet a priori, ce préjugé qui était de dire que les mariages sous Kampuchea démocratique étaient des mariages forcés et qu'en discutant avec vos collègues, vous avez entamé une autre... vous avez vu un autre angle et entamé du coup une autre démarche de réflexion. Donc, ma première question est de savoir... par rapport à cet a priori que vous aviez au départ et par rapport à votre angle de recherche, quels sont les écueils que vous avez vus qui se présentaient à vos recherches de terrain et comment est-ce que vous avez envisagé ces recherches et quelles précautions avez-vous prises au préalable pour pouvoir examiner ce point de la façon la plus objective possible.
Pay more attention. At first, I startled myself by stumbling upon a belief that I had that I couldn't validate.
The refugee Thai border camps.
So people were in the Thai border camps for long periods of time. This particular couple wanted to marry. They met each other in the camps and they wanted to marry. And they were told that they had to marry in a Christian service so that they could be registered for host country passage. And when they came to me, they were very confused about their identity. They felt Buddhist on the inside, but in order to have particular services, they acted Christian on the outside. They never had a traditional ceremony in that context. It was that first case of hearing that wedding in that context that led me to start reading on Cambodia. And in my readings on Cambodia, I came across documents such as work by Elizabeth Becker, who used the word forced. So I was reading a lot of historical documents in many different places trying to get information. And the word forced, I think, subliminally just stuck with me. But when I was challenged by my colleagues when I came to Cambodia the first time, having only had experience of Cambodian refugee narratives being told to me. After that time, that's when I decided to go back into those historical documents and to see, was there a study done on this subject? If there was a subject done, was it done with multi-phased sampling rather than judgmental or selective sampling. So that's what started me on this project. And admittedly, when I started to get more and more data to the contrary of the word forced, and things were starting to brew a bit in Cambodia about the subject, and there were early solicitors, lawyers who were looking at that problem and sometimes seeking me out for conversation. I discovered in those conversations that oftentimes my topic of inquiry was less than appreciated, which then gave me more determination to move forward with a PhD on this topic. I hope that answers your question.
Ce qui sous-tendait ma question était de savoir, par rapport à ces écueils-là et au fait que je comprends bien le thème était si le terme brûlant était source de discussion et de débat, la question des mariages sous conflictuel démocratique, comment avez-vous abordé vos recherches et quelles sont les précautions dans votre méthode de travail que vous avez prises pour justement ne pas partir d'une idée préconçue, mais de partir de, du matériel sur lequel vous travaillez. Je ne sais pas si ma question est plus claire.
Sorry.
C'est vrai, il y a toujours ce délai de traduction et en anglais et en khmer.
I started my research by dividing it into three phases. The first phase was exploratory. So I'd like to clarify, the first doctoral study that I did was a pure quantitative study, but now I was moving into a qualitative study. And in order to do a qualitative study, one requires a lot of measures to make sure that study is reliable. So, in that regard, I decided to do my study, called multi-phased sampling. I chose my first sample with only two criteria. I wanted to interview couples who were together, in part so I could have male and female and find consensus between the two if I spoke to them individually and then compare their stories.
secondly, the criteria that I had was that
they were married inside Cambodia and had no refugee status.
So, which meant I did my study inside Cambodia.
Those are the only two overriding criteria that I selected for my sample. And so then I went from a purpose of sample that was selective, and I would like to qualify selective sampling because one can approach selective sampling from two perspectives. One is selective and one is judgmental. Sometimes in qualitative research, a researcher will choose a judgmental approach to a study because they want to canvass, let's say, somebody wants to study opinions about abortion in a country, so they might select a sample from either a pro-abortion NGO or an anti-abortion NGO just to be able to get a sense of the influence, if you will. I chose to not use a judgmental sample as my first port of call. I chose to use a selective sample, which is used in early stages to explore a phenomenon. So I was looking at this phenomenon called weddings under DK.
So
in that regard, I chose couples so that I could understand how they experienced their weddings, where they experienced them, how they described them without me influencing that description, asking questions that were not leading, from a selective perspective, and trying to get a sense of couples who were married in the same places with different leaders. So I might be able to understand within a village structure what influences there may have been that interacted with my respondents' experiences. So that was how I originally chose my first sample. Now, I will say that my first couple that I traveled with was a convenience couple. So under selective sampling, we can choose a selection of convenience. The reason I chose this one couple was because it was the first couple that challenged my use of the word forced. So I chose them as the first couple to travel with, to interview three times together, separately, to get a sense of the consensus. I traveled to the work camps with them, where they were. One was in the boys' camp, and one was in the girls' camp. And then I heard their story at their camps about how they were each called for a wedding. I traveled with them to the wedding site in a village where there are other people living who were married in that same place at different times. And I traveled with them the road they took, that they walked, the night after they were married, when they were told that they could go to the woman's parents' home to stay for 3 days. So that was my first sample. Again, a sample of convenience, so I could really just get more of a sense of where I was going to go next. Then I moved that into the second phase, which is going from a convenience sample to a selective sample. What I discovered when I was in that village was that there were other couples that had been married there at different times by different leaders. They told different stories about what their wedding was, the structure, the procedures, and I basically snowballed, if you will, maybe dungballed, I don't know what term to use when there's no snow in Cambodia, but I, to use the term in literature, I snowballed my sample, then only wanting to talk to couples who were married under DK, but who were in villages
at times
when different leaders presided.
So my first example was much larger from the central
zones. I traced things in the administrative zones, much larger in that
central zone
and southwest zone than other zones. So that was the first sample of 22. In analyzing my data, I tried to keep that separate from moving on next to a more random sample.
So I can speak more about
as well if you'd like me to.
Avant de passer à la question de l'échantillon aléatoire, je voudrais vous poser quelques questions par rapport à ce premier échantillon que vous dites de convenance, qui est essentiellement sur la zone centrale et la zone sud-ouest, ces 22 personnes. J'ai compris que vous avez interrogé ces couples à plusieurs reprises. Donc ma première question est de savoir est-ce que c'était espacé dans le temps, est-ce que c'était sur plusieurs mois, plusieurs semaines plusieurs années, puisque vous avez indiqué que vos recherches étaient étalées sur 8 ans. Et ma deuxième question, vous avez utilisé le terme « j'ai voyagé avec eux ». Quelle était l'importance pour vous de vous déplacer sur les lieux de ces mariages? Et qu'est-ce que ça vous a apporté en termes de recherche?
Again, a nice critical question. That first couple, I met with them over 3 years, in part because when I wrote up my summary, I brought my summary back to the couple to make sure that they agreed with what I summarized. So that's one reason I worked with them for such a long period of time. Secondly, I traveled and filmed them. I actually had a French film person who did film me when I traveled with them as a way of having visual and auditory data. So the traveling with them to different sites and speaking with them on the different sites, I have all of that on film. And that was very useful for me to be able to not only analyze content data, most research that is done solely on written transcripts is usually content-based data in the final analysis. I wanted to triangulate content data, process data, and context data. Now again, to digress a moment, because I had already done a PhD study, and because I had been a PhD supervisor and senior researcher for 25 years, I designed the study so that I could triangulate that data, because I, again, was seeing comments about weddings under DK based only on content-based data. So for me to triangulate that data was essential for me to use film. That's the first thing I'd like to say, and I used film quite a lot for many other interviews. Second, important reason for me to choose to return to sites with my respondents. As a psychologist and a trauma-informed psychologist, I'm very aware of how place history stimulates memory. And so it was important for me when I was interviewing to be able to hear the history in one's home, and then travel with one to the site to see, did the history I was hearing change from the time I heard it in someone's home to the time I was with them standing on the site? And yes, it did. That required a lot of analysis on my part to determine which is the real story. And that is why I went back to people again and again and again to get that reliability check from them about the story. The other thing I want to say about that was that in terms of ethics of my work, I had a duty of care to the safety, the psychological and the spirit-based safety of the people I was traveling with and interviewing. And I did work with a psychiatrist that is known to the courts, Dr. Lena Hewitt,
because he was
more of an independent psychiatrist. I worked with him so that if I was concerned that someone might have bad dreams that night, or they needed some other assistance psychologically, I asked their permission to refer them to Dr. Lena, and Dr. Lena made visits or made follow-up contact with those people.
J'ai d'autres questions à vous poser sur ce premier échantillon de 22 personnes, mais puisque vous venez d'en reparler, je voudrais rebondir dessus. Ce matin, en répondant aux questions de M. le Président, et là encore à nouveau, vous avez utilisé le mot éthique, vous avez indiqué à quel point c'était important pour vous, dans le cadre de vos recherches, d'avoir une supervision académique pour des raisons éthiques. Et vous avez également évoqué le fait que c'était important d'avoir une revue, une relecture de vos travaux indépendante et transparente, si je reprends les mots que j'ai entendus ce matin. Et enfin, vous avez indiqué que vous ne vouliez pas avoir de fonds d'ONG. Donc, ma question qui découle de tout ce que vous avez dit ce matin et de ce que vous venez encore de dire, pourquoi est-ce que c'était si important pour vous d'avoir cette relecture académique indépendante et d'être financièrement indépendante d'une quelconque ONG? Pourquoi c'est important pour vous?
Pausing just a moment, because it's a very complex question for me and my experience in association with, at times, NGOs in Cambodia, sometimes as a consultant, and the word independent consultant sometimes gets compromised. So, for example, I was a consultant to a project where I did, I thought, a thorough survey, but I think that I never saw the final report because my final report may not have been in favor with what some of the funding sources may have wanted to have received. So I have had experiences, and that's not just inside Cambodia, it's in other countries as well, where when NGOs are struggling very hard to keep the organization going. Sometimes, not always, sometimes there are compromises to take on projects with funds that compromise outcomes, or what I would consider to be neutral outcomes. I think that's not unknown. So in that regard, I really wanted to not be associated with any agenda by any NGO, one way or the other, on this particular topic. This is a very, has become and has been a very heated topic. And I felt that heat very early on in just cursory discussions that became emotional on the part of perhaps someone soliciting an interview with me. So in that regard, I wanted to be very contained in my research. Admittedly, I did go to the Documentation Center Cambodia a couple of times for documents early on in my research. That was only in the early stages of my research. But other than that, I tried to stay pretty neutral. And with regard to me asking for ethics guidance by a committee that two committees that sat in two different universities that were not invested in any discipline or any research study. They were just there to determine if the study meets criteria for a reliable, valid, and culturally informed study. I wanted that endorsement. Again, because I just was experiencing the intensity of this topic. And one other reason I think I was so determined to try to, we can't be perfect 100% of the time, but to try to do the best I could with regard to this study is because I kept hearing one narrative after another of people's experiences where they described their weddings as being real. And the more the topic of forced came onto the agenda, the more those people that I was interviewing started to feel ashamed. And so I worked very hard to just see if I could track data that led to an outcome rather than me leading my data to find an outcome. So I wanted to try to see how much I could gather that which could represent better. Not best, and there are more studies to be done on this topic, but that could represent better the general population of Cambodia.
J'en reviens maintenant à ce premier échantillon de 22 personnes que vous avez interrogées plus précisément dans une localité. J'ai compris qu'il y avait un premier couple qui a été le couple déclencheur et que vous avez suivi, avec lequel vous avez voyagé. Je n'ai pas compris, en revanche, si vous avez suivi ce même parcours de filmer ou de voyager avec les 21 autres couples de ce premier échantillon.
As much as possible. So in that sample, the book is the easiest place to find that sample because I only put those in the back of my book in coded colors for the couples. I had one couple that was married in Phnom Penh. It was a soldier who ended up marrying his former fiancé, and they took me to the site where they were married in Phnom Penh. But that couple led me to find someone in Siem Reap. So, you know, it was really that sort of snowballing, but that couple not leading me to someone in Siem Reap, it was more that they did not have the experience in being interviewed with me that I was interested in anything other than what their experience was of how they met and what happened next. And so then they said, but we know someone who was married in Siem Reap. And that's kind of how that sample happened. Now, I ended that sample by what we call in qualitative research saturation, which is how I ended my second sample of 180 people that I surveyed. Once I started to get a repetition of themes, then I finished that sample. So the repetition of themes that I started to get was differences in place and time in how weddings were conducted based on the leader who either chose the couple or based on the leader who approved of the couple who the parents chose. Once I started to get some saturation of my data, I then developed a survey that I used for the 180 people in the second sample.
Donc, si je comprends bien, sur le premier échantillon de 22 personnes, c'était des discussions générales où il n'y avait pas forcément de de formulaire préétabli et à la suite de ces 22 entretiens, vous avez eu suffisamment de thèmes pour établir peut-être quelque chose de plus structuré en termes de questions pour le deuxième échantillon plus aléatoire. Est-ce que j'ai bien compris votre méthodologie?
I'll give just a little bit more detail. Because that first couple that I interviewed and traveled with, the couple that challenged me initially, through that first couple, I developed my questions for the other 10 couples, though they were the questions I used for the first couple. And if I may, I'll just read those questions. They're on page 4 of my book. Tell me when you first met your spouse. Tell me what was happening in your life before you met. Describe the wedding day in as much detail as possible. Was it a real marriage? What happened after you married? Were you told to have sexual relations by anyone before or after your wedding? What keeps you together? What and who protected you? What protects you now? Kindly describe your own or a family member's pregnancy during that time. Can you tell me about the delivery of your child? Please tell me about the first few days following delivery. Kindly describe the care for your child and others' children in the commune. These questions came out of that first interview, traveling interview. Initially, I was only going to be doing the wedding stories. But when I traveled with that first couple, on the road I became very sick. I ate eggs that were not very nice. So that whole day of the interview, I would have to go into the woods because I had an upset stomach. And when I did that, women looked after me on that day. They rubbed me, they cared for me, and I said to the woman who I was traveling with, oh, is this how women treated you during the Khmer Rouge when you gave birth? And she said, no, not at all, no one touched us. And she said, we can take you to where I gave birth if you'd like to do that. It was that first couple that had me then start for the rest of my research, tracking the wedding stories and the birth stories. That is how that happened, and that's what happens sometimes when you just start out with a qualitative method, and then I stay with that.
D'accord, donc si je comprends bien, ces questions que vous venez de nous lire, c'est des questions que vous avez posées à l'intégralité des personnes avec lesquelles vous êtes entretenues, les 197 personnes qui sont l'objet de votre thèse.
That's correct. However, for the other 160, I created a survey so I could get more data, things around the rituals for people to describe their rituals in detail. Those were the formative questions. The survey had more detailed questions with those questions as the major outline.
Vous avez évoqué aussi ce matin, en répondant à M. le Président, que en dehors des 197 personnes qui ont fait l'objet de votre étude de façon plus approfondie, vous aviez aussi eu interrogé spécifiquement plus des anciens des localités que vous avez visitées pour parler des mariages avant 1970, avant de revenir précisément sur ce que vous avez collecté sur le mariage traditionnel avant 1970. Je voudrais savoir si, en dehors de ces questions sur les mariages avant 70, vous leur avez aussi posé des questions sur leur propre mariage, ou leur propre expérience des mariages sous Pampuchéa démocratique, si, même si vous ne les avez pas spécifiquement inclus dans votre étude. Est-ce que c'est quelque chose que vous avez fait ou vous êtes contenté pour ces autres personnes de parler des mariages traditionnels?
First, to clarify, it was 192 people in my study. Secondly, because I formulated my methodology and my progressive sampling, I did not waver from that. The people that I interviewed in the villages, again, well over 1,000, were people who were not married during Democratic Kampuchea. They were people who were elders, oftentimes who sometimes helped arrange some of the marriages of young people during DK. But they spoke to me about their weddings. Many of them were married before 1960 in terms of the age of people that I was interviewing, and spoke to me about how their marriages were arranged, what the day was like, what they wore, whether there was a popiel or just traditional music. I just tried to gather as much data to sit beside the anthropological and ethnographic studies that I had read. Mostly, most of them have been done in French. I know that May Ebihara's work is most referenced a lot in some of the studies that have come out of Phnom Penh. But I wanted to see, was what they were describing consistent with what I was reading? Because what I was reading, of course, was oftentimes, ethnographic studies are determined by the village in which the researcher is doing their study. So I wanted to see what rituals actually were part of most places and what rituals were specific to a region in Cambodia. So it was really just about confirming what I was reading again and again and again, and also looking at how elders would describe their weddings and comparing that regionally. And then that gave me a database from which I could see whether those in charge of those weddings during DK were allowing some rituals to flow in, and others maybe
not. Justement, je voudrais vous poser quelques questions sur la notion de mariage arrangé dans la tradition Khmer. Mais avant cela, je voudrais rebondir sur ce que vous avez dit précédemment en citant un passage de votre thèse, donc document E3-1794 à l'ERN en anglais seulement 00482443. Et vous parlez de la question du mariage en Kampuchéa démocratique et vous dites en anglais: social pressure to describe the Khmer Rouge weddings as false has been unyielding. Mon accent anglais doit être vraiment épouvantable, je répète. Social pressure to describe the Khmer Rouge weddings as false has been unyielding. Et à la suite de ça, vous évoquez deux anecdotes, notamment la manière dont vous avez pu être approché par des journalistes qui savaient que vous travailliez sur la question et qui donc ont utilisé le terme « mariage forcé ». Et vous dites ceci, je cite toujours en anglais, « In my reply, I suggested that this is a complex topic and that classifying Khmer Rouge weddings as forced in a country where arranged marriages are common is perhaps misleading. Ça me fait tout de suite rebondir sur ce que vous avez entendu sur la manière dont le mariage était arrangé avant le Kampuchea démocratique et ensuite on verra sur ce qui s'est passé sur le Kampuchea démocratique. Mais vous, dans les entretiens que vous avez eus et dans ce que vous avez lu dans les ouvrages ethnographiques ou anthropologiques que vous avez étudiés, quel était le rapport au consentement des époux lorsqu'on parlait de mariage arrangé? Je m'explique. Nous avons avant vous une experte, Madame Nakagawa, qui expliquait que dans le cadre des mariages traditionnels, le mariage était avant tout une affaire de famille plus qu'une question entre deux individus. Ma question, c'est
Firstly, just to respond to your middle comment regarding Ms. Nakagawa's statement. Yes, it's a family affair, but not one family. Families affairs, community affairs. So I just want to say that it's not just about families, it's about families and community usually. And oftentimes, even today, someone outside the family will participate in arranging marriages or arranging engagements oftentimes. Unfortunately, there is no engagements arranged under DK. So that's my first comment regarding Ms. Nakagawa's comment. With regard to arranged marriages, again, I went through the literature with regard to the ethnographic studies. There were differences, certainly, across the different studies. So, for example, in some of the ethnographic studies on weddings by foreigners, they noticed different patterns in the amount of time that communities took for wedding activities, anywhere from 1 day to 3 days to 7 days in some cases and in some regions. And that has changed across time and place. With regard to ritual objects and ritual progression, I was interested in not just studying the rituals. I was interested in studying the sequence of rituals. That's part of my process data, not just the content of what's present at a wedding. I was interested in, again, the sequence in which objects are introduced, music is introduced, music is withdrawn, Hair is cut. Needle nut is introduced. Again, I was interested in mapping the sequence because I wanted, because I did that also with my respondents when they talked about the wedding. I documented the sequence by which events happened to them. So interestingly, there were just so many differences in the sequencing of the wedding in terms of what happened before the wedding under DK, in what happened during the wedding, and what happened after the wedding. There are very, very many differences that I found in my study that I can speak to at some point. With regard to the loss of access to tradition, it was profound in terms of traditional sequencing and traditional rituals. That was profound. But I have separated out in my study the issue of ritual erosion from the issue of whether weddings were forced or not.
I worked
very hard to not even ask that question, were they forced or not? But I did come to a conclusion that they were not forced. And that was basically because of how people described their weddings to me, their experiences to me, their agreement with the choice of the person, whether that agreement was with the choice of the mother or the father or the brother or the uncle or the auntie, who sometimes went to a leader and asked permission for a man or a woman to marry. They were usually in agreement.
Je vais revenir plus précisément à ces différents récits que vous avez entendus dans le cadre de vos recherches. Un point que j'ai omis de vous faire préciser dans le cadre de votre méthodologie, je crois comprendre que vous ne parlez pas Khmer, en tout cas pas couramment, et que vous avez forcément eu besoin d'interprètes. Est-ce que vous pouvez indiquer comment ce choix d'interprète est intervenu et comment vous avez travaillé avec le matériel que vous avez en Khmer et comment ça se passait au niveau de l'exploitation de ces données?
The reason that I tried very hard to use audio taping of the interviews and digital film of the interviews was that I had a recording of the interview. Yes, I traveled with an interpreter. In fact, regardless of how good any of my languages are, I would not do research unless it were my first language anyway, for fear of not having some understanding of some nuanced meaning. So I traveled with an interpreter. That person interpreted that material for me. I went back to Australia with my material, and as I did even when I was at the Showa Foundation in my research, I got an independent translator to translate that first translation. And the reason for that is because the person who was translating for me and traveling with me themselves was a survivor. And so it was important for me to have a fuller sense of the transcript from someone who could translate Khmer, who didn't have that experience, and who lived in another country. So that is how I did my research, even though I read French, and I went to the cultural center. I took copies of all the documents, and I had a person with French as their first language make sure I had them independently translate that.
Of course, it was much better than my translation.
J'ai compris également en lisant votre texte que dans le cadre de l'identification des personnes, ou en tout cas des premières approches avec les échantillons de personnes interrogées, vous avez eu recours à des étudiants qui vous ont aidé dans votre travail. Donc la question est de savoir quel était le rôle de ces étudiants, est-ce que vous avez systématiquement rencontré les personnes qu'eux-mêmes ont rencontrées. Est-ce que tous les 192, pour avoir le chiffre exact, les 192 personnes qui figurent au niveau de votre thèse, est-ce que vous les avez personnellement interrogés ou est-ce que vous avez eu des entretiens de seconde main, entre guillemets?
Thank you for that. Yes, I did use students to assist me, students from the Royal University of Phnom Penh, students who were in their last year of university, who had done their research course. They were not students of mine, they were not going to be graded by me, they were volunteer students, there was no second game for them, I did not instruct them to choose people based on any particular persuasion about the weddings. I met with them four times, trained them in how to use the survey, trained them in how to stay with the original questions and to not add any other questions other than saying, can you tell me more about that? That was a question they asked a lot. They brought that material back to me. Usually in Khmer, that was translated. And then I checked the translation of that translation. And then I took all of that information and I put it into the surveys. I did not with those interviews other than with seven return to re-interview that cluster, that sample. That's very important to stay up front. I used the same method for the remaining sample.
Thank you.
Based on something the witnesses just said, I just want to raise this before the break so we can take advantage of the break. I understood from her last answer and one a few minutes ago, if I understood correctly, that she developed a survey with questions that these students were to ask, and I think it would be very helpful to the parties and to your honors to have a copy of the questions that the students were to ask. I presume these go beyond the 13 topics from page 4 of her book that she read. So I would just ask if the President of Honor could possibly ask her during the break, if she has that in English in Khmer, to provide that to the legal officers so parties could get copies.
Thank you for that.
Je continue, je n'ai pas d'observation particulière.
Can we ask, I think I saw the expert note, so do you have this questionnaire? Are you willing to provide it? Thank you. Then we'll ask our legal officers to collect it during the break.
Can we ask our legal officers to collect it during the break?
Thank you. like to make a statement about that. Maybe the word survey isn't completely accurate.
The students were given names and inquiry of those 13 questions that they had. Those were the questions that every single subject, I prefer the word respondent, was given.
They did 100 and two of those, I did 90 plus the 22. Yes, I have a copy of that. It's more a form that I have that I will make available to the courts where they recorded that information based on those 13 questions into a format that could be easily analyzed. So it's just a two-page format that looks like that. It has things like one column, ceremony details, food, drink, music, speech, teaching, promises to Angkor, clothes, chroma, color, other. And they filled in this form, but I certainly will make this document available to the court. Yes.
Thank you very much. 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 Thank
Monsieur le Président, une dernière question avant la pause, si je peux me permettre. Je n'ai pas compris en matière de chiffres, excusez-moi de vous faire répéter. Je n'ai pas compris par rapport à la question que je vous posais, de savoir si combien d'entretiens ont été menés par ces étudiants que vous n'avez pas vous-même.
That's fine. I did 90 of these forms with the related questions, plus the 22. So that's 112 that I did myself. The students did 102. I will clarify that when the students went out into the field, it was more so that I could get regional samples. When they went into the field, we were in constant contact, and we consulted. And any questions they had, any questions they could contact me. And I followed up with randomly, I chose 7 random samples from those 102 surveys they did, really more or less to do a reliability check on their work.
D'accord, donc si je comprends bien sur les, excusez-moi si j'ai un peu de mal, mais sur les 102 entretiens que vos étudiants, que les étudiants ont menés, vous en avez vérifié entre 7. Est-ce que je dois comprendre? Est-ce que les entretiens qui étaient menés par les étudiants étaient enregistrés également.
Admittedly, only one quarter of the students recorded the interviews.
Et sinon, sur le reste, ça veut dire que vous travaillez sur les notes.
Yes, it does.
Yeah, but how?
They're recorded. Answers to the 13 questions.
And then,
again, this form was developed
with
as much data as I could get to start collecting on, such as one column you will see, such pregnancies from 1975 to 1979, number of pregnancies, number of live births, number of stillbirths, and place of birth. So this form was developed towards the end of my 90 interviews that I did, so the students would then take these forms into the field with these 13 questions to help, if you will, do another validation check on the material, the details of the weddings and the births. I think the form will be self-explanatory to the courts.
Je pense, Monsieur le Président, que vous voulez marquer la
pause. មកដល់មន្ត្រីច្បាប់ដែលចង់មកច្បាប់របស់អង្គជំរះថ្លាដំបងដើម្បីផ្ដល់ចែកជូនទៅដល់ភាគីពាក់ព័ន្ធក្នុងរឿងក្តីនេះដើម្បីអាចជាមូលដ្ឋានក្នុងការដេញដោលនាពេលខាងមុខបាទឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសម្រាប់ហើយឲ្យប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីនេះទៅទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 3:00 សូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចសម្រាប់ការសម្រាប់ការមន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលតុលាការរមរួមផ្ដល់កន្លែងសម្រាប់នៅទទួលរងចាំដើម្បីសាក់សីដល់អ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងរងពេលសម្រាប់នឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់កន្លែងផ្ដល់សេចក្តីកម្មក្នុងបន្ទប់សន្និការនេះវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 3:00 សម្រាប់ចុះ